Life could be a dream. Life could be a dream. Life could be a dream if I could take you up in paradise up above. If you would tell me I'm the only one that you love, life could be a dream. Sweetheart, hello, hello again. Shaboom, and open we'll meet again.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hero Movie Podcast, your greatest source for superhero movie and TV discussion in the multiverse. I'm your host, Adam Portress, and he doesn't dream. No way, no how. Sweet Sean Zakovacs from the internet.
I'm the Sandman sidekick, Ice Knot.
And you had him at Talking Bird, Bruce Leslie.
I'm a prickly pear, and I'm not a dream. I'm right here, and I'm real, baby.
He's real, and he's spectacular. Welcome back, everybody. We are talking.
Great. That was
Harry
great.
Hatcher's left breast.
I think we found a new t-shirt. This week we are talking about The Sandman. Holy moly, has this bad boy been in development since nearly as long as I can possibly remember. So
probably since you were born.
Not quite. 1991 was when they started talking about this actually being a filmed product.
So, was it that back when they wanted that guy from 90210 to be the Sandman? Ian Ziering is Sandman.
Oh my gosh. Wow. Boy, what a great timeline we could have been on. But unfortunately, we passed by all of that, but we are with the Sandman in 2022, and Neil Gaiman's involved, no less. So we'll see how all of that kind of shakes out and everything. But before we do want to say a big thank you to those who support us over at patreon.com/HMP. Those fine, intrepid people get the pre-show, post-show, and of course, the Dinger Zone, and it being the top of the month here and everything. We do want to say a big shout out to all the people here at the top level over in that $40 level. We've got Derek, Matthew, and Tim. Derek, Matthew, and Tim coming in at that $40 level. Thank you guys so much for that. And of course, in that $20 level, Alex, Brian, Jens, Jessica, and Jessica, Larry, and Nate, and Noah. Oh my gosh. So many of those people. Thank you guys again so much, and everybody that came in at the obviously $5 level is the most popular one of all of us. But no matter what level that you support this show at, you get pre-show, post-show, Dinger Zone. We don't make you sit through a whole bunch of ads pre-show, in the middle of the show, and all that. Let me tell you, that drives me bonkers more than anything in podcasts, is having to listen to 45 minutes worth of ads that we all know that you fast forward through. Your time is a little bit more valued than that. And
I'll tell you how much that bothers me after these words from our sponsor.
Yes. but we don't do that anymore, because when a couple people have come by and been like, hey, would we like to do some sort of sponsorship thing on your show, and you ask how much it is, then you laugh at them for that paltry amount and say, my people are worth more than that, because I tell them straight up, I'm like, unless you're going to pay me more than what we're getting paid for the Dinger Zone, I don't really even want it. And they just go, okay, we're not going to pay you that. And so we don't do
Remember
none of that.
Remember that time they paid us $90 million for an ad? And we buried it because we thought it didn't fit our image.
It didn't fit the style.
Wait,
guy.
What?
Well, I mean, we thought we'd tell you later. That was more of a first Sean kind of thing.
It was that ad that was going to have Michael Keaton and Brendan Fraser on our show, and we decided it didn't fit our image.
It just didn't go quite as well as we thought it would, and you know, rehearsal's not so hot. So we just kind of decided to can it, all WB style. Just decided to throw it out. And just
that
go,
explains why you both have personal aircraft.
Mine is a hovercraft by choice, not by need.
I'd go seaplane, baby.
You can't go wrong with a seaplane, and you can't go wrong supporting us over at patreon.com/HMP. Again, big giant thank you to all of those guys. And honestly, and we even had a couple people that have sent us messages, like our buddy Orange Crust said, hey, I'm going back to school. I'm going to have to, you know, get my membership down for a little bit here. I'll bring it back up when I'm... And that stuff's absolutely, totally cool. We love it. And Orange Crust, you're just staying on anyways, man. And so
if it's financially feasible for you to donate to our show, that's awesome.
But if it's
but only if it's financially feasible.
Exactly. If it's not financially feasible, at least go tell a friend or something like that, or review us on iTunes. Give us a 5-star review, a.k.a. Humdinger.
Dang it.
All right, boys and girls, that's all we got for that. Let's get into it. Here is the trailer for The Sandman.
I'm the king of dreams. Ruler of the nightmare realm.
What are you doing here, Etty?
He's coming, isn't he?
Yeah.
Morpheus. The Aneromancer. You know the Sandman.
He's a fairy story, Etty.
He's no fairy story. He's back.
Good to know.
What's he got in his hands? Open your hands now!
Forgive me, sire, the palace, the realm. They are not as you left them. With you gone, the realm began to decay and crumble.
The dreams and nightmares no longer seem to recognize the monster. You will remind them.
He's free. He's out of his cage.
Alrighty, that was the trailer for The Sandman. You know what time it is.
It's time for Bruce's Comic Book Connection.
Oh, long time coming Comic Book Connection for this one. What do you got, Bruce?
Well, The Sandman is a landmark comic written by Neil Gaiman that was first published by DC in 1989. Now, initially, it was pitched as a revival of Jack Kirby's 1974 Sandman, who's not to be confused with the Golden Age Sandman, who is a member of the Justice Society of America. Jack Kirby's Sandman was very similar to the New Gods in appearance and was originally intended to be the actual Sandman of popular myth, who was, quote, eternal and immortal. Now, Kirby's Sandman was assisted by two living nightmares named Brute and Glob, whom he released from domed cells with the help of a magic whistle. And I got to tell you, there isn't a day that goes by that I couldn't use a magic whistle and a couple of living nightmares. Like, let's say a family of squirrels built a nest in your laundry room. Well, you blow your whistle and you get the living nightmares to chase them off. Price of gas is too high on your multi-state road trip. You get the nightmares to siphon some gas out of a parked police cruiser. You know, the basic stuff. Anyway, this incarnation of Sandman's main task is protecting children from nightmare monsters within their dreams, especially one young boy named Jed. And you know, this is before he loaded up his truck and he moved to Beverly Hills, that is. Now, in his final adventure, the Kirby Sandman teams up with Santa Claus to battle the Seal people who are dissatisfied with the Christmas presents. Look, not all comic book stories have the depth and complexity of a Neil Gaiman yarn. Sometimes you just got to take what you can get. Now, after the Santa adventure, this Sandman kind of drifted off into obscurity, not being spoken of for years. Then, in 1983, the legendary Roy Thomas decided to give him an origin. It turns out Kirby's Sandman wasn't an eternal immortal, but he was actually Dr. Garrett Sanford, a UCLA psychology professor who became trapped in the dream dimension while saving the life of a U.S. president who was in a coma being terrorized by a powerful nightmare monster. And speaking of nightmare monsters, Adam, do you have a list?
Well, if that comic connection wasn't enough, let me sell everybody on this show that's been trying to be a thing since 1991, because this sucker's got everything. We got Skinny Little Dream, or is it Morpheus, or the Sandman, or Dwayne? Who knows what this kid's name is? We got the Impossible Girl. Happy has turned from a unicorn into a raven. If only he was voiced by Ray Rice. We got Charles Dance, Dance, Dance like you done pooped your pants. 100 years in one episode, so you could say this thing moves a little quickly. We've got gender swaps, same-sex relationships, anything to make it seem like this story wasn't turned out 30 years ago. We got crazy magic, demon summoning, gargoyles, dream sequences, pocket sand, stretchy cinematography, people getting dusted, old folks turning older, and it's a Neil Gaiman property, so you know there's going to be a library, and it's going to be the most important place of all. This show's got everything.
That is an excellent point. I've never put those two things together.
That man always has a library in every bloody thing he ever
he
does.
He does, and it is the most important
part. It's always crazy. It's like, oh, we must all, of the library books are disappearing. The words are disappearing from the world. Shut up. I never read Sandman before. Sandman was one of those books that, like, when I went to the comic store, you saw it, and the covers always look cool. You pick it up and you flip through it, and it's just like, wow, I thought Chris Claremont was wordy. So then you put it back, and you're like, I don't need 45 minutes to read half a chapter of this thing.
I'll tell you, like, in the 90s, if you were just some ridiculous, stupid goth boy, The Crow was your favorite comic. But if you were sophisticated, educated, goth female with a lot of insight, your favorite comic was almost certainly Sandman. Like there was definitely, like, I'm trying to think of how to put this to it, but it's kind of like one of these is your Motley Crue and the other one is your Guns N' Roses, you know, like on the surface to the person who looks at the album cover, they're the same thing. But man, there's a whole lot more talent in one than there is in the other. Don't tell James O'Barr I said that.
So Bruce, what is your relationship with Sandman, Neil Gaiman Sandman?
I mean, I really like it. I've read everything. Mm-hmm. I've even read Overture that came out about 5 years ago, kind of the prequel. I own them all in trade format. I have some of the single issues. Like I probably have the first, I have to go like pull in my prize collection. I probably have the first 12 issues or something, maybe more than that.
Nice. Single
issues like bagged and boarded and put away in a safe place, i.e. somewhere in this room.
Sure.
But yeah, I mean, I've read them all. I love them all. I haven't read them like all multiple times, but Preludes and Nocturnes, the first trade, I've given it a few go throughs. Mm-hmm. I've always thought Neil Gaiman, if he wrote more comics, like he is not a comic book writer. He's a writer who has written some incredible comic books.
Yeah. Yes.
If he had written more comics, he might be my number two comic book author. I don't know. That's just me kind of like speaking out of my butt because we're talking about Sandman right now. But he really did kind of feel like the heir apparent to Alan Moore because the way he took over Miracle Man and how well he did with it. Yep. And he has a way of writing that is not like other comic book writers because he's not, you know, I don't think he would ever think of himself first and foremost as a comic book writer.
No, he thinks of himself as British Fonzie.
Yes. And I totally applaud that choice.
For me, I was hearing about this book just about all the time in high school and then in college. And the people who would come up and ask me about it were people that I didn't necessarily like.
Yep.
And so forever, I stayed away from it.
Yeah.
And that was a mistake because I'm sorry, go ahead.
One problem with the comic in its actual time, like I picked it up a few years later. Mm-hmm. I didn't pick it up in real time, but these were also people who were listening to The Cure.
Yes.
They didn't just like Sandman. They had to let you know that the X-Men were lame. Yes. That Batman was lame. Super. Yes. 'Cause you know, I like everything. If it's good, I like it. I definitely don't narrow myself down to superheroes or non-superheroes. And there were a few people that might have the audacity of saying Sandman is so much better than Watchmen, you know, so that would put me at odds with some people too.
Sure.
But yeah. I didn't pick it up till it went to Vertigo and away from DC and I got separated and The Cure weren't as popular and stuff like
that. For me, it's just like you're saying, you know, being a fan of the Preacher comic books, people would see me reading that and then a certain type of person would go, oh, well then you must love Sandman if you're reading that, like, you know, looking down on me reading Preacher. and I was like, well, I don't, because of people like you, you know, I'm thinking to myself, I would never say that to their face. And so it took me years. I mean, it took me years to read it. And then once I finally read it and separated, it's kind of like the people who love Workaholics, the TV show Workaholics, made that show so terrible for me to watch. It's the same thing. It's the same thing with this.
It's like I was soured on Parks and Rec because the type of people who would make and share Ron Swanson memes.
Right.
And I thought, if these people look up to Ron Swanson, this guy must be a D-I-C-K, you know?
Yeah.
But then when I actually watched the show, the guy is sweet and he's reasonable. And it's like, wow, I can't believe I let these butt nuggets take something wonderful away from
me. He let memes control his life, everybody. Don't let your life be controlled by memes.
Well, I mean, that's also kind of an Adam Portress thing to, it's an Adam Portress thing to do, to say, I don't like this thing because I don't like its fans.
You're not wrong. You're not wrong at all.
And so it took me a long time. And then, you know, once I read them and I was a little older, you know, I had kids of my own by the time that I read them, and they were just really wonderful stories. And the part, like you were saying during the comic book connection, Bruce, is that when you realize just how many different levels these books are hitting at the same time, I mean, there's one story arc and it's the one where he meets Shakespeare, And it's like working on four different levels at the same time. And, you know, I'm not like the biggest Shakespeare fan, but like, it's just so remarkable reading that story to the, it's so good. In fact, that it made me go to my friend who is a big Shakespeare nerd, like, hey, what should I do here? Like, what should I read here?
And I mean, it's been,
and it didn't stick.
It's been years since I read that arc, but I seem to remember it specifically Midsummer Night's Dream, which makes sense since he's dream of the endless.
Of course. And that's what I mean. Like, it just works. It worked four different ways. And it's just so well written. And, you know, I always talk about bulletproof scripts. Like, that story arc is so bulletproof. You're not going to outdo what they do in that story. And so, you know, there was a lot to live up to for this TV show.
And also, like, in the 90s, late 90s, probably when I'm really reading it into the 2000s, at that point in time, this is so cerebral and it's so trippy and it's so otherworldly. This is one that's like, I love this as a comic book because, you know, people used to say Watchmen was unfilmable. I never got that. But Sandman seemed unfilmable at the time. Now, you know, CGI, special effects, things have come a long way. Also, as viewers, we've come to accept, I think, more and more out there kind of storylines as we get more stuff thrown at us on streaming. So now it is maybe closer to filmable, and we'll talk about how well they do with that. But I don't know if you would agree with me, Sean, but at the time I was reading it, I thought there is no way, unless it was animation, because you can do anything with animation. But I was like, there is no way that they could make this into like a live action movie or TV show.
Oh yeah, I thought that it would have been some really ridiculous mistake if they did it, you know, in the late 90s, early 2000s, you know, to a backdrop of Limp Bizkit. Like, that's not what this is.
Hey, they would have been classier than that. They'd have had like Deftones or something. That's about it. That's about as far as you go.
Oh man, it's got to be nothing but Joy Division for something like Sandman.
You are right. It would be Joy Division, absolutely. But you know, like, so when you're when it seemed like they, like, without even getting into the show part of it, just my reaction to hearing about this, you know, like the pre-production of this, hearing that Neil Gaiman's on board, hearing that there's, that it's got a big budget, hearing that, that they're going to do 10 episodes, like, you know, all of these things made it seem a little bit better. Where I was like, well, maybe there's good people working behind the scenes to try to make the best version of this.
Because if this was a network show that had 20 episodes to fill, your budget would get squashed and you're not going to put as good as a show. 100%.
But one thing that does always make me worry a little bit, and once again, I'm sure eventually we'll actually start talking about the show, but it always gets me worried when it's a Warner Brothers project that's not being distributed by Warner Brothers. Yes. You know, it's on Netflix and not HBO Max or HBO. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, HBO, Game of Thrones, Westworld, they got a pretty good track record for some prestige TV. They had the Watchmen show. I don't know if you guys remember, but that was good.
Yeah, I liked it.
It was good.
So you have to say you might have felt a little bit better if you heard, and I'm not talking about HBO Max exclusive, but you heard Sunday nights this summer on HBO Sandman, because that's where they put the winners.
You're 100% correct. It would make it just far more of a draw, and that's what I feel like. And again, I'm coming from somebody who like is aware of the comic as a property, and of course you've seen little things in Wizard all the time growing up. But so like coming out of it, you know, it's just, I don't know that it's nearly as known today as it was say 20 years ago. And I feel like if you'd had that in that like kind of eight, like you said, HBO Sunday kind of slot there and everything, you could get a whole lot of like, you know, a bump and noise from this thing. I think it's a weird one to just do a big jump on Netflix.
Like, once I watch it, I've got an open mind, but like going into it, I'm a lot more worried when I hear Warner Brothers property going straight to Netflix or Hulu instead of going to HBO.
Well, I mean, that's more than likely a money thing where, you know, well, Netflix is offering X amount of money. We can actually just make money off of this thing.
Well, if they needed an extra $90 million, I know where they could have gotten it.
Has Netflix has had some sort of a previous relationship with Neil Gaiman? Yeah.
Yes.
So that's probably, I think he's done something, a thing or two for them in the past. So I feel like.
Oh, no. It's,
oh, he was
it's,
Amazon.
It's
Prime.
Amazon. It's Amazon.
Oh, that's what, I knew he was with somebody. So I was trying to put it together. I'm like, well, maybe they did a thing with, no, but yeah, you're right. That's Amazon. Shucks. I don't know. Because
that's my favorite Neil Gaiman book of all time is Good Omens.
Now, let me ask you guys this, because this is something that I'm kind of curious as somebody who's consumed Neil Gaiman's work in as much as live action stuff between the movies and TV shows and all that kind of good stuff. Even like his episodes of like Doctor Who, by the by.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I in this and all of those, I definitely sense a definite Neil Gaiman voice. I would imagine that carries through the work, that you always kind of, I don't know, it just feels like him whenever his stuff is, you know, at least in live action form. I'm like, oh, I feel like this feels like a Neil Gaiman kind of thing.
I don't think Stardust and Sandman feel at all alike.
No, I don't either.
I just mean, and like, maybe like the way his dialogue is delivered. I think it's more like that.
The only thing that I think he has in his writing voice that is through everything is that everything feels like a bit of a fairy tale, no matter what.
Yeah,
he's
a little
writing.
Dreamy.
I mean, even when it comes to American Gods, like that's another thing where it's like, yeah, this is kind of fairy tale-y.
Now, the only things I'm really familiar with, Sandman, Miracle Man, I'm familiar with his comic work, probably all of his comic work. I think he's written some other stuff that I've read too. You know, like he wrote, I'm pretty sure he created like the guy that's basically Harry Potter before Harry Potter was ever around. I can't remember that DC character's name. Read all his comic book stuff, familiar with American Gods, familiar with Good Omens. And the one thing I would say, Good Omens, I won't give him too much for, because I really feel like Terry Pratchett was the strongest influence there. But I feel like he writes for himself, which is something a lot of writers don't do. Like, he is not writing to market. He's not, he's not Stephen King in it. You know, he's not out there to write as much as possible and make as much money as possible to be as successful as possible. I get the idea that he's pretty comfortable with what he's got. And it, just like why I love Alan Moore, Alan Moore is writing for himself. Of course, he writes in a totally lunatic way that Neil Gaiman doesn't. But the one thing I would say of everything of his that I'm familiar with is I feel like he's writing for himself and not for an editor, not for a market, not for anybody else.
I believe that's true. Like the feeling that I've kind of always got from him is like it felt like this was something that he was passionate about and everything. And if other people got it and enjoyed it, it was great. But it always seemed like it was kind of going for whatever his particular taste was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he's very, you know, his sensibility is very British, which kind of jives with what I like to read. You know, when I'm reading, that's why I love Good Omens so much, is just all the small details in that book. It's just amazing. But
it's almost as if all the best English literature comes from England for some reason.
and then when there's a book like American Gods that comes out and it's so epic and wonderful, quite honestly, and he took ideas from, it was almost like a Tarantino-ing of his writing, where like, hey, I'm gonna pull from this and this and this and make this thing, and it's such a fun read. I tried watching the show, but what's in your head is so better than what's on a on a TV screen that I just couldn't keep watching it.
That's why I don't read books, kids. No, sir. It ruins your TV.
And I'm not talking about his writing style, but some issues of his approach. I will never not believe that he's not inspired, at least in his comics, by Alan Moore.
Oh, of course. I mean, it's his biggest inspiration when it comes to the comic books.
Yes. And I mean, his voice is totally different. He writes things that Moore usually wouldn't. But the idea, you know, this Sandman published 3 years after Watchmen, I think, when it debuts. And Watchmen is, we're taking a bunch of C-level characters, somewhat obscure characters. We're going to kind of give them our own spin and make this new story that has nothing to do with Charlton Comics. Well, he takes this Jack Kirby Sandman character, totally re-envisions it, where it has nothing, you know, it is not even the same character anymore. Just like, you know, Rorschach is no longer the question. Morpheus is no longer Sandman. And just like Watchmen, there's actually not any team in Watchmen called Watchmen. They're called Crime Busters and Minutemen. There's no Watchmen in the comic Watchmen. Morpheus can be called Dream. No one ever calls him Sandman as a name. Somebody might refer to him as the Sandman, you know, like Mr. Sandman, yeah. Dream Me a Dream. But but it's that same kind of idea where we all know what it means. And a lot of people say, oh, look, that character is Sandman. But you know, it's really not. It's Morpheus or Dream.
So let me come to this with you guys, because this is the part where I feel like maybe there's somewhat of a little disconnect, because from what I had been hearing from people that were big Sandman fans previous to this show and everything, is they were really praising the show a whole bunch. They really liked it. They said it seemed very accurate. The things that they changed, they understood why they changed them and all that kind of stuff, sometimes mostly in a good manner, it seemed. That said, having come to this anew, I feel like maybe it felt maybe a little bit rushed to me, at least particularly the first episode and everything. And I know we've got a lot to cover within that, but it feels like, man, we hit the ground running, and I like hit the ground running, but we're so running that, like, I'm honestly not 100% really caught up until like episode 3.
Well, one thing I will say is I feel like they spoon feed you a little bit more than the comic does, actually. Like, you feel like you're hitting the ground running. As someone, I mean, I haven't read the comics in a while, so there are details I don't remember, but that first episode in particular is all like, oh my gosh, they're going to make a whole episode out of this. Like, I feel like in my mind, he gets rescued from his circle that he's trapped in by like page 3, and they make a whole episode out of it here. Uh-huh. And I'm like, are they doing like the whole Overture prequel in this first episode? I can't quite remember which was in Overture and which was in Preludes and Nocturnes. But anyway, I don't feel like they are moving too fast, because the comic gets to the end of episode 1 more quickly than episode 1 does.
Yeah,
interesting. Interesting.
But I will say this from my own personal experience, particularly as a Game of Thrones fan, I think Charles Dance is such a strong actor to build that first episode around.
Oh, yeah, man.
And this isn't broadcast television, so you're going to probably binge it. You don't have to win somebody over in that first episode. But if this was, let's say, HBO Sunday night, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock slot, 9 o'clock slot, having Charles Dance be the centerpiece for your first, and I'm sure that Warner Brothers got him because of those Game of Thrones connections, but
of course,
having him be the cornerstone for your first episode is a good move, because it's really going to get people to sit through it and want to follow. Of course, you're probably going to be bummed out when you tune in and he's not in the rest of the series.
But he brings a gravitas to that first episode that legitimizes the show right away. Just because of the caliber of actor that he is, it legitimizes the show right off the bat.
And, you know, I love it's a little bit, you know, if Alan Moore had written this, his character wouldn't be Roderick Burgess. It'd be Aleister Crowley. But the way that Neil Gaiman is doing it, like, we know it's supposed to be Aleister Crowley, but we call him Roderick Burgess. Pretty clear that's who he's an analog of here. And it's very faithful to the comic. I mean, you can look, and the comic book looks like it was literally used as storyboards for some key scenes here.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, I don't remember it well. I do remember the books.
I don't either, but I've seen where people have taken the panels from the comics and screenshots from the show and put them side by side.
Oh, wow,
really? I have the benefit of having seen other people's hard work to show us just how similar they are. But myself, I don't always remember the details either, because it's been a while. Like, I feel like they've introduced the Corinthian much earlier in the show than they do in the comic. Like, I feel like we don't get to the Corinthian until he goes to the serial convention. But here they're giving us the Corinthian as a villain. And I think you do need to establish an antagonist early on. And since it's not going to be Charles Dance, they do need to get the Corinthian in pretty quickly. And just another cool piece of trivia, the Corinthian from Eastern Kentucky, Prestonsburg, Kentucky, not too far from where I came from. And his last name's Holbrook, so maybe his cousin was the Holbrook guy that went to my high school.
Mm. Well, Boyd Holbrook, this is two performances from him. This performance and him in Logan, where he seems to be someone who I've never seen before, who is just captivating in these roles. You know, he seems, at first blush, when you look at him, he seems like somebody who could be like a Jay Courtney kind of a thing.
Yeah.
But he's not.
And he has sort of a Boyd Holbrook has like an origin story that makes me want to shoot myself in the foot because it infuriates me. But he was, it's like Harrison Ford. He was working as a carpenter at Jenny Wiley State Park, and somebody saw him and said, "You're too handsome to be a carpenter. Let's put you in movies."
That's gotta be what a rough life.
Is that what happened with Patton Oswalt?
Yes, he was walking in a mall in Atlanta, and somebody said, "We got to sign you up to be a rapper, Mr.
Much too handsome. I'm much too handsome."
So Mac Daddy and Daddy Mac got discovered in a mall because somebody said, "You guys look like rappers," and it showed in their career. It showed that they had no background. Sorry to way for me to punch down on like 14-year-old kids.
Yeah, and one of them's gone now,
and
Bruce.
One of them's gone.
How dare you?
Man, was it Rob or Fab that's gone?
That's a different group altogether. Now you're just racist.
Thanks. So let's go ahead and let's swiftly change this topic.
Please.
Oh, okay. Are you sure?
Let's go to $1 million question.
Yeah.
What do you think of the casting for Sandman? Because so much, the casting for Morpheus, because so much hinges on what the viewer thinks of Dream.
Okay,
I will tell you. You know what, Adam? You go first.
Let me start because I've got no impression of the character. First of all, I think I look at this guy and I'm just like, did they go, we need a young-looking Neil Gaiman here? Because he kind of looks like a young Neil Gaiman, if you think about
it. Well, so does Morpheus in the book.
Yeah, in the book, yeah.
Speculated that Morpheus was intentionally made to look. Like, Neil Gaiman said, oh, he's supposed to look like Robert Smith from The Cure. And everybody's like, no, he's not.
It's like, it looks like
the
you.
The artist is like, no, I don't even know who Robert Smith is. This is Neil Gaiman I drew here.
Because it looks like he could be a young Neil Gaiman. So, like, that's good to know that is. All right, sweet. But yeah, I think he's all right. I thought I liked the voice, the VO and stuff at the beginning, and I'm like, is this going to be this guy's voice? And it's nice and deep and everything, and it doesn't feel like it's super phony or anything, so I buy it. But so far, so good. I mean, three episodes, the first whole episode, he's stuck in a big giant jar and stuff, so there's not a whole heck of a lot we can get out of him there. But in the next two episodes, what little bits we get to see, I like so far. But I don't really know much of the character outside of what I've seen here.
I mean, you really got to roll in the goth to get Morpheus right.
And I tell you skinny little guy. Holy moly, eat a sandwich, my man.
I'll tell you what, I feel like he needs to be taller, though.
I think he's perfect.
Okay, well, I'm going to tell you what I told my wife. And it's like, okay, if this were a movie and it were a theatrical release, the perfect person, this is the casting director saying, the perfect person would be Robert Pattinson. But yes, we need to get TV budget Robert Pattinson. So yes. I told my wife, this is like, you ask your mom for Robert Pattinson. She says, we got Robert Pattinson at home. You know that, yes.
Yeah.
And then my wife told me, Tom Sturridge is like Robert Pattinson's best friend. And it's like the fact that they look alike is probably intentional. Because she's like a Twilight fanatic, so she knows this guy. Because he used to be friends with Kristen Stewart and Robert Pattinson, and then when they broke up, he went Pattinson's way and left Stewart behind. So,
good man.
But of course, it would be weird if the Batman was... Actually, it'd be awesome if Bruce Wayne turned out he was actually Morpheus. I'm not really Bruce Wayne. I am Morpheus. And they got 2 inches taller. But yeah, so, the guy reminds me of Robert Pattinson, and Robert Pattinson is always going to be kind of like the neo-goth ideal from the whole Twilight thing.
Sure. And that's what my lady said too, watching this the other day. She's like, that guy looks exactly like the dude from Twilight. I was like, yeah, he does.
Like, how tall are you, Sean?
6'4".
See, I feel like Morpheus should be about your height and then have the goth hair and be pale. And he's got the goth hair and the pale, but I feel like he's closer to my height than yours.
Well, I think that he's perfect because he says a lot with his eyes, this actor. You know, he gives some great stink eye.
All the things I said about Robert Pattinson, at no point would I ever say he is not an excellent actor. Like, I used to hate Robert Pattinson from Twilight just because it was cool to hate Twilight, but he has earned my respect as an actor. So I think he would be a great Morpheus with the eyes and the acting, but this guy does a good job. You know,
he does. I think he's very good. I think that he has the hardest job of anyone on this show because everybody else gets great, you know, like they're great lines, they're great asides. He gets a lot of, here is what's happening in the plot. It's a lot of what he gets.
Yeah, he's
after
a lot of
stoic episode.
And looking and thinking and like a lot of wheel turning going on.
And he's not a sympathetic character. I mean, I think it's the reason why Gaiman started this series off the way he did, because, hey, we're going to kick this character in the balls for, you know, for a bit here, because he's not sympathetic, other than we just saw him get kicked in the balls for, you know, for an entire episode here or a couple of issues in the book. And so, like, when, you know, everybody keeps talking about that too, like, you know, you need to start listening to the people around you, blah, 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 blah. I've watched this entire series, so I'm apprehensive about talking about the nitty-gritty about this so much, because it's all wrapped up into my head as one big view. I will tell you that if you guys have, you guys gone, did you go more than three episodes?
I just went three episodes, and I got some talking points that I think will keep us in within bounds.
Yeah, just okay. Three. Just three for me.
But I without spoiling anything, I'm going to tell you there's one episode that is the standout of this entire show. And so if you weren't thinking about seeing this anymore, you should at least wait until you see the episode that is the standout. And I'll go look for the name of that now.
And, you know, there was a time when we came awfully close to Joseph Gordon-Levitt as Morpheus. What kind of wig do you think Jogo would have worn? Like, what kind of goofy, like, would he have looked like he was in a Dragon Ball Z Halloween costume? Because, you know, he would have to go wig. There's
that,
no way.
Also, is he doing that same voice that he did in Snowden?
Oh, that would be great. Oh, here I am, all kinds of dreams and stuff. What's going on? And
have to call in Tom, you know, call up Tom Cruise's people and say, we need all your apple boxes because we got Jogo here trying to be Morpheus.
I need some pocket sand, guys. What's going on?
Now, he
would have been fun, but honestly, like, you're right, the wig thing had to happen, because Jogo's like, he's like me, he's got like just fine hair that doesn't poof up, you don't have a lot of layer to it and everything, and you gotta, for whatever reason, the hair is a portion of this character. Whenever you think about what the comic looked like, the hair is a big, you know, it's a big thing about it.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta have a specific look or it's not Morpheus.
Yeah,
it's
doesn't
not
count.
Sandman comic. Now, one thing I will say, and I've already said this before, like, panels of the comic look like they're directly used to storyboards here. And so far in these first three episodes, there is some extra stuff that I'll get to that does like feel a little bit different from the comics, but a lot of it feels like such a literal, direct interpretation of the comics that, like, if you've read the comics, this is only sort of like a nostalgic, it's like you get a thrill out of seeing the story in the comic you already know being brought to the screen, but I don't know if it adds much of a new dimension. But then I kind of remember how many people I meet that just love comic book media, and they're just not readers. Like me, I listen to audiobooks, don't read a whole lot of books on paper, and there's a lot of people that want to get into Sandman, and if you're gonna not read the comic and just watch an interpretation, I think there's some value to the direct interpretation. What do you guys think about, like, direct versus, you know, adapting it a little bit?
I think it depends on who's doing it. You know, I think that the folks who made this show have basically made the best version of this book you can make, you know, because there are moments on the show where it, you know, you're going to roll your eyes a little bit because it's just that kind of, it's just that kind of source material. It's cyclical, the show, also, where there's some really great moments, you know, when he has to go to hell, that's an amazing moment. When he, you know, there's other things that happen in the show, but then at the same, you know, the serial convention is another great moment on the show. But, and I haven't even mentioned my favorite part, but there's also moments where you're just like, okay, like, come on, what are we doing here? You know? And it's the same thing with the books, in my opinion, where, you know, it's a little too flowery when it gets flowery. It's a little too dour when it's dour, but then there's these great moments where you're just like, well, that's just perfect.
And, you know, I tell people that this is one of the most direct translations of a comic that I've seen based on these first three episodes. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Death is black and Lucifer's a lady and John Constantine's a girl. I'm like, that is so superficial.
Yes.
The story, the scene, the wardrobe, the dialogue, it's like just perfect. And also, people forget that when you first see Lightbringer, you know, Lucifer in the comic, Lucifer is drawn as a female. I mean, the idea is that Lucifer is androgynous or genderless or gender fluid, but it is drawn to be a female when you first see it. And then it kind of becomes male in some later incarnations. But people forget a lot of that.
Lucifer Morningstar.
And there is some stuff, you know, maybe I don't remember the details as much. Like, I don't remember much about Dr. Destiny other than him being in that cafe and the whole story arc inside the diner with Dr. Destiny. But here I feel like they're really giving us more backstory and they're kind of filling out the Dr. Destiny character more than they did in the comics. And it may just be that I don't remember everything the comics told us about John D. You may not even know who I'm talking about, Adam, when I say Dr. Destiny.
Oh, no.
the guy in the guy who escapes from the mental institution and he gets the ruby from his mom and starts exploding people as he walks out.
Okay.
John D, John Burgess, Dr. Destiny.
Gotcha. Okay, yeah.
I do feel, Sean, like they're building, like they're letting us understand that character's motivations and his story more than they did in the comics.
Oh, without a doubt. And also, I mean, you've kind of shown your hand also by having David Thewlis play the character where, you know, like, well, this guy's up to no good.
Oh, man. Now, Patton Oswalt, is he like in everything comic related that needs a voice actor?
There has to be a moment where you say to yourself, you know what? I'm in enough of this.
Yes.
Yeah.
I love Patton. Yeah. I think he's amazing. But you can only do so much comic book nerdy nerd stuff.
He's the donkey, and it's like all this voice acting, the donkey in Happiness.
Oh, I totally forgot about that.
He was the little like sidekick of Harry Styles at the end of The Eternals, was it?
Yeah, he's MODOK.
Yeah, he's MODOK. He's now this DC bird. I'm sure he's probably some other stuff that people will tell us that we've forgotten about. The guy is voice acting in a lot. Yeah. I mean, good for him. You know, voice acting is a nice way to make a check, but Is he overexposed or is he just like,
listen, I don't think you're wrong. I think like there will come a point where you start diluting the brand, as it were.
Yeah.
There's going to be a show where multiple characters in the same episode are voiced by Patton Oswalt.
Hey, listen, you say that, but that's animation. They just do that all the time anyway. So
that's true, man. Frank Welker has done every voice in an
like,
episode.
Like, you're just going to have him be that. But I will say this, I really liked the, is it a crow? Is it a raven? It's raven, right?
It's a raven.
It's a magpie.
I like the animation on it. It looked really good. Like the voice and everything, like it matched up. The thing was actually acting and it didn't look cheap and crappy. And I was pleasantly surprised by that.
Way better than those old commercials where they would just elongate the cat's mouth when they would go, hey, somebody just pooped in their box.
Oh, man, shove the carrot up the horse's butt or whatever.
Yep, so that's how they did it.
Can we move on? Can we move on to
I hope Silver this indeed. Show's
I don't know. I can go with butt carrots all day.
Just don't eat it afterwards.
Oh, Jesus. What the
next? I don't care how many times you wash off a butt carrot. I'm not going to eat it. That's where baby carrots come from. They shave off the butt part and all that's left.
This show's off the rails.
All right. Let's talk about Constantine and this show's version of Constantine, Joanna Constantine. Mm-hmm. Constantine, one of my favorite DC characters. Once again, I don't remember too many details about how deep they go into Constantine's story in Sandman comics. This feels like there's a whole lot of Hellblazer.
Yeah.
In our introduction to Constantine here with Astra and everything, this is all Hellblazer.
Yeah.
That's what it kind of like. Awesome. And so Jenna Coleman coming in as gender swap Constantine. I think most of us probably know her from Doctor Who. That was like kind of her big giant break thing and everything.
I think most of us who know her from Doctor Who probably have some level of crush on her.
Oh, yeah.
Gender or sexual orientation. She transcends it. I mean,
she's adorable.
Adorable. Yeah, she was dating Kit Harington at the time, so, you know, she's a looker.
She should step up from Kit Harington. I'm sorry, she can do much better than that.
Oh, yeah, now she's probably has. I have no idea.
I don't know. I look at Kit Harington, I'm just like, he's like a C. in the, like in the world of Hollywood. I'm like, he's not an ugly looking guy, but I'm like, I don't know what anybody would.
I don't know. I've seen that final season of Game of Thrones. He's got maybe the best butt on any man.
Fair enough. But Jenna Coleman,
I'll send
though,
you some Snapchats.
Thank you. Very attractive. And at first I was just like, cause I heard she was going to be Constantine or something. So I was just like, well, let's see how this is. And because I have a very, you know, kind of ingrained idea of who she is based upon, you know, a one character that she's played that I you know, really, really know.
Yeah, only character I know, too.
So I was just cool. Like, okay, let's get into this. And at first I didn't buy it. And I'm just like, oh, this is not. But as it kind of went on, I was like, I kind of buy her in this role. I don't know why. It sort of worked. I'm
sure. Yeah, she's a good actor.
Yeah.
And I kind of wonder, like, some people might say, well, they really wanted to cast her in this role, so they made Constantine Joanna instead of John. But Warner Brothers will do this thing. Like, you can make a movie about Gotham City or a TV show about Gotham City, but you're not allowed to have Batman. And I wonder if John Constantine was one of those things where, like, you cannot use John Constantine, but you can use Joanna. Like, I don't know if it's one of those weird things, because Warner Brothers will make certain characters off limits to properties for whatever reason. And I'm wondering if making her Joanna has something to do with that.
I certainly don't think that's out of the realm of possibility. When you hear about, like, the Lord of the Rings thing, did you hear that this week, where they were just like, oh, yeah, they said, Peter Jackson, would you like to take a look at some of these scripts? And he just goes, yeah, I'll take a look at some of the stuff for you. Or he said, I'll look at them, whichever you like. But at the end of the day, they didn't show anything to him. And supposedly it's just because they were like, oh, Warner Brothers has the rights to that Lord of the Rings stuff, and they don't want to, you know, mix peanut butter and chocolate together. So they're just like, well, we don't want to, you know, let Peter Jackson, the guy who did, you know, the three best Lord of the Rings movies ever, don't let him in on the
worst
process.
So, you know, it's a coin toss.
It's fair. That's a fair statement to be made.
I mean, I'm saying there's only six of them. Made the three best and the three worst.
It's true. So, but I wouldn't be surprised if that was a thing where they're just like, oh, if we just change the gender, boom, we get past all of the all of our restrictions and stuff. But it did feel kind of Hellblazer-y, sort of that vibe going on with the spells and everything.
And it's why next season, instead of Swamp Thing, they're going to have Marsh Item.
Terrible. Absolutely terrible.
But man, think of all the Joanna Constantine action figures they'll be able to sell after this.
Tons and tons. Like I said, overall, like I feel like I like the show so far within these three episodes. The toughest part for me is, like, I guess it feels like this is a very bingeable show, in as much as they're going to just parse the story out to you as it kind of goes along here, and you'll just get the information as you get it. They're not interested in, like, hey, here are all the things, here are all the, you know, different, you know, plot points, and let you sit with these characters for a minute and kind of get to know them and stuff. You do hit the ground running a little bit. It's a double-edged sword. I like it and I hate it, because I'm like, oh, we're getting going and we're not wasting any time. But at the same time, too, what connection do I have with these characters? And I feel like unless you're continually watching, perhaps that's the only way to really get
there. Oh, you're going to connect. Okay, trust
good,
me.
Good.
You will connect.
In the first three episodes, Adam, we didn't make it to Lucifer, but Gwendolyn Christie plays Lucifer in this show.
Yeah.
Yeah, and when we do make it to Lucifer, I'm going to want you to remember that this is the exact same character from the comics that Fox Lucifer show is supposed to be about.
Ah, okay.
And this is an actual honest-to-goodness interpretation of it versus a very, very translated version that you got on Fox. And I'm not saying that it's not a good show. I know people love that show.
Bro, that show went for way longer than anybody would have possibly imagined. And then got picked up, what was it, Netflix or Hulu, or somebody picked them up?
Netflix.
What's not to love? Satan solving crimes.
That is, I just want you to see how different the two Lucifers are. And that is what happens sometimes when you adapt things.
We got Captain Phasma and Richard Cheese. I don't know what's going on.
Richard Cheese.
What it kind of looks like to me in those promos. That's
right. Wow, I never would have thought of that.
Cheese against the machine.
So that's what I figured. As far as I'm concerned, though, like, this has got enough to kind of bring me in within these first three episodes to kind of spark enough interest. And again, like you said, being a thing that, you know, you'd heard about since the 90s and everything, I'm like, let's see what we've finally got. We've waited this long, for heaven's sake. Let's at least make it through a season of television and see what's happening.
I never dreamed in 100 years they would actually bring in the House of Secrets and the House of Mystery and the whole Cain and Abel thing, because it felt kind of like a gimmick even in the comic. Like, I'm just impressed with how how clearly fans of the source material the people making the show are, and probably a big part of that is that it's Neil Gaiman. But I could also say Neil Gaiman saying, yeah, you know, I wrote that Cain and Abel stuff as an homage to the older comics, but that probably doesn't need to be here. And they're like, no, we love it, we're putting it in.
And I'll tell you, let me tell you, because I figured out what episode it was, which was my favorite. Episode 6 is my favorite of this series. It's terrific. And
you divulge the title, because I'll probably know what it's about if you tell me the title.
It is called the...
Most of the show episodes are titles of issues of the comics.
The Sound of Her Wings.
Okay, got it.
And there's two storylines that are happening in this one episode that it's just they're just the best. It is the people working on the show are doing their best work, and Neil Gaiman is also doing his best work. It's just terrific.
Those wings sound like this. The sounds of the wings.
So I guess just to get to a little bit of like review type stuff here too, before we move on and get our final ratings and things, I think we all agree that this show looks beautiful, or am I speaking too much for you guys?
No, I was really pleased, because there's so much computer stuff happening in the dream world, which is okay, cause it's the stupid dream world. But you know, when you're in the real world, it is just such a wonderfully shot show.
It looks good, but like you said, like in the dream thing, with specifically the one that kind of sticks out is the guy on the beach and everything in the first three episodes mm-hmm. that we saw. The guy on the beach is like, it's got a really interesting, unique look to it while he's in that dream at the beach and stuff. And you're just like, I don't know. I just like, in a well, world where we're
about Mallorca, I had to think of it. I was like, there's a beach scene. And
yeah. It was just like, oh, a way that we've never really seen dreams portrayed before, in this odd kind of what seems like a very dream kind of like, ooh, this something's not right here. It doesn't feel quite right. And so where you have that kind of weird and odd CGI, it actually uses it to its advantage, because it doesn't seem real. It seems odd. It seems strange and off and everything. And that's when you kind of go, oh, am I dreaming right now? Kind of thing. I don't know.
Yeah, and I mean, it's kind of like Freddy Krueger, where dreams are just as real as reality in this. It's like dreams and reality are two sides of the same coin. Therefore, in a way, dream is the lord over both dreaming and reality. Just like when you get to meet a sister Death, you'll see not only does she represent death, but in her own way, she represents life too, because without death, how much value would life have? That kind of thing. Mm. It's a really cool Neil Gaiman-esque approach to it.
And around here, we wonder how much life would be worth if we didn't realize how this television show relates back one-to-one with Sylvester Stallone.
Now that is a segue. Good job by you, Portress. Thank you, Adam. I have a prepared statement. Well, here we are again, Mr. Stallone. Another week with a show that was produced almost entirely in England. Part of the world you don't hang out in. I'm not entirely sure of the reasons for this, because I think you would be great in an Edwardian period melodrama about manners. Maybe you need to speak with your agent. Now, today, I must speak to you about Mark Hamill, not only because he does a killer impression of you, not only because he's literally the only person on this entire project with a direct connection to you, but also because he was the biggest star to show up at the April 1978 premiere of your movie Fist. I mean, can you imagine how awesome it must have been being Mark Hamill in 1978? You're 25 years old. You just starred in the biggest movie of all time. You have a gigantic movie career ahead of you. And before you got the role in that space movie, you probably thought you were going to be a character actor for the rest of your career. But now here you are. It's April 1978. You show up at a movie premiere and people want to speak to you just so they can tell their friends that they hung out with you. No one is coming up to you and saying, you know, I thought your podcast was better in the old days. It must have felt like every dream you ever had has been surpassed, and you're only 25 years old. Now, Mr. Hamill does the voice of Merv Pumpkinhead on The Sandman, and I had no idea it was Mark Hamill, even though he's probably my favorite character on the show, which leads me to ask the question. When people complain about big stars doing voiceover work in animated movies, would they consider Mark Hamill to be a big star or a voiceover guy? Would those people complain about Mark Hamill? Because even though he's best known for playing Cockknocker in Jay and Silent Bob Strikes Back, he's also known for his voiceover work, like playing Darth Bane in the Clone Wars cartoon. If you're asking me, and you're not, I would classify Mark Hamill as the rarest of breed that he's actually both things, because he's done so much voiceover work that I wouldn't call it a stunt when he does the voice of Skeletor on the new He-Man series, or the new voice of Chucky, or even other roles in Batman properties. But he can play himself on The Simpsons when he shows up on a talk show because he's there to surprise Adam Scott, who's always wanted to meet him, and Adam Scott loses his ever-loving mind. We can understand that because he's Mark frickin' Hamill. And when he's a guest star on The Muppet Show, no one would ever say that's all you could find Mark Hamill, because he's Mark Hamill. And not by coincidence, you are also a guest star on The Muppet Show, Mr. Stallone. My favorite moment on your episode is when Link Hogthrob walks into your dressing room and warns you there's a few groupies running loose in the theater. You should watch yourself. And he tells you you can borrow his aftershave or cologne that he keeps in a drawer in your dressing room. A pig named Link Hogthrob. That is killer. Anyway, that's the Stallone connection this week. I hope to hear from you soon. Your pal, Sweet Chauncey from the internet.
Well, nice. Here at Hero Movie Podcast, we have our own Batman and Robin rating system, but we're not going to talk about that right now because we haven't seen the whole show yet here. But Bruce, having seen the three episodes, what are your kind of expectations for what's coming up?
Well, to me, as a comic book fan, it feels like a nice love letter to the comic book, a multi-million dollar, hard produced, a lot of work love letter to the comic book. I'm glad that we're definitely all on board with sticking with it, because I do want to stick with it, and I look forward to like doing a wrap up and seeing what our final thoughts are. One thing I'm most curious about, though, is the person who hasn't read the comics, what you're going to think of it, Adam. So I'll be listening when we get to your turn to give your thoughts.
Yeah, that's and honestly, that's why I'm kind of still interested enough in this, is that like I said, it was one of those things, one of those Hallmark names that you hear forever. And even if you didn't read it like me, you were still at least, you know, fairly aware of what it was in its existence, and that a lot of people really, really seem to dig it. So with that, and the fact that this has gone around for so long, and these first three episodes, quite strong. I was, I don't want to say surprised, but also at the same time too, I like how the episodes are also as long as they kind of need to be. Like episode two is like 34 minutes. Don't stop trying to give me extra 20 minutes when it don't need to be there, everybody. Just yep. Make them as long as they need to be, and then just moving on to the next one. So yeah, I am looking forward to that. Sean, sell us on this last kind of half, because we'll come back to this in probably a couple weeks, I guess.
It's wonderful. It's better than the first third of the show.
Okay.
It seems to really kick into gear in the fourth episode. As a matter of fact, I was going to text you guys and say, hey, the third episode ends kind of poorly, so maybe you want to watch the fourth episode, but I thought that was unfair to, that's an unfair ask on Saturday. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like that's unfair. So I am so pleasantly surprised by this show. This is one of those things where it seems like everything that they put into the show would be something that I absolutely can't stand, but because it's just so expertly delivered, I really, really enjoy the show. It's not perfect. It's not even my favorite TV show currently on TV right now. But boy, it really is a fun show. And
we can't all be Real Housewives of New Jersey there.
You like what you like, and you like it because it's good and it's quality.
I'm not mentioning that show that I mention every week on the show. not even paying us.
So we'll cover the rest of the Sandman on Netflix in not too awful long. So
probably though. I mean, we have a big slate.
That's why I say not too long, because I don't know when the heck we're going to be able to fit it in, but we're going to try to do it at some particular point. So that is it, everybody. Bruce, where can they find more of your work on the internet?
I'll tell you what. if you're the kind of person who thinks farts are the funniest thing ever, you're going to want to watch my YouTube channel on Tuesday, which will be the day after this releases, because there's going to be a big fart themed anime production that I've got for you. So if you think farts are the funniest thing ever, youtube.com/C/Bruce Leslie. Also, on Sunday, the day before this show comes out, I did a reaction to the first episode of My Hero Academia, seeing what happens when the world of superheroes and anime cross. So you may want to check that out.
Sean, what else?
You know, the episode that I knew Parks and Rec was a great show is the fart scene where they say they can't make fun of Jerry for an entire day. And then he drops something and he bends over and his pants rip and he farts at the same time.
So good.
That was literally the moment I was like, well, now I am a gigantic fan of this show, because they had spent the last like 4 or 5 episodes showing you just how smart they are. And then they just completely throw it out the window with Jerry ripping a fart and ripping his pants at the same time. Oh, so funny. Anyway, where you can find more of my work on the internet is I do a podcast with these two dumb nuts called 30 Questions. And we are usually going over some nerdy hero property or Marvel or a Star Wars. And we ask 30 questions about that episode. But I'm guessing that if you're listening to this still, you probably already know that we have a 30 questions podcast.
Yeah. If you've stuck around this long, you're probably, you know,
oh, and also,
you
know, you're part of the crew.
Yeah.
You know, there's probably like, I can't even imagine the giant spillover of the just the sheer amount of people who listened to our Clone Wars 30 Questions podcast. We got so many more listeners after that to follow us over to this show.
It poured in like, you know, just like, you know, there's a leak in the house and it just like Las Vegas. It just leaks everywhere and you don't care. Right. That is it, everybody. Join us next week. We're going to be talking about Prey, which is the new Predator sequel on Hulu right now. Been getting a lot of really great reviews and stuff.
I've seen it, and I'm going to watch it again next week because it's good.
I know there's some people out there that are going to email us or tweet at us or something and saying, when are you going to talk about Paper Girls, the best comic book adaptation out in years? And I promise in 2 weeks, we're going to cover Paper Girls.
We'll
right,
stop
guys?
Burying your emails. We'll quit it. We'll quit doing that. So.
All right.
We'll get through here. So join us next week for Prey. That is it, everybody. Join us next week for Sweet Sean's Go Back from the Internet. Bruce Leslie, I'm Adam Porters. Stay super, everybody.
Bye, my name is